chance it again. I'm about to let them know where I'm from. Don't take me there again. I just call on Jesus, my friend.
Good afternoon, LJ3. It's Pastor E here, and I'm excited to be back with you on today. Listen, we are going to jump right directly into the text today, and we're in part two of our series, It Was All a Dream. If you missed last week, go back and watch it, but we are in part two of It Was All a Dream. And if I was to give this week's message a title from this series, it's going to be Don't Forget Who's With You. Don't forget who's with you. So in preparation, we're going to go through another chapter. So last week we went through chapter 37 in Genesis. This week we're going to go through chapter 39 in Genesis. So go ahead, grab your Bibles, open them up. We're going to read some verses. Some of it I'm going to give a summary of, give you the Pastor E standard version of it. And so get that ready and pull it out. So if you remember where we ended off last week, we ended off with Joseph, who was one of the youngest brothers of his father, and he was the favorite. He was loved. There was no ifs, ands, or buts about it. His father made it clear that he loved him the most. Not only did he make it clear, he made sure everybody else knew about it because he gave him this robe of many colors, this robe that's usually given to the oldest as a certain honor that the oldest gets. He, being one of the youngest, got this robe, and all his brothers hated him because he was the favorite. This is where we're at right now. And so Joseph, being the favorite, received two dreams. Two dreams he got. He got one dream saying that his brothers had these sheaves, these loads of grain, and that when they stood them up, everybody's loaves bowed down to Joseph's loaves in the middle, which was interpreted as the brothers were going to be bowing down at some point to their little brother, the favorite, Joseph. And the brothers even hated him even more. Not only that, he had a second dream saying that the moon and the stars were bowing down to him. So it made it look as though not only was his brothers going to be bowing down to him, his mother and his father would also bow down to him as well. So his brothers hated him, and they said after the second dream, they were jealous of him. Come, no, I'm giving you a quick summary. Go look at last week's message if you missed any of that. So this is where we are right now. These brothers are hated Joseph, and they were jealous of him. And because they hated him and they were jealous of him, watch what they did. They decided to sell him into slavery, which is better than the first thing they wanted to do was kill him. But at the end of the day, they said, you know what, we're going to sell him into slavery. So at the end of the chapter, we find out that they sold Joseph for 20 shekels of silver into slavery. So now he's a slave. And so he's a slave, and this is where we begin in verse 39. He's a slave to a man named Potiphar. Now, Potiphar was the captain of the guard for Pharaoh, so he had some clout. He was one of the king, the Pharaoh's officials. And so he was the one who went and bought Joseph. So he owned Joseph now. Joseph was sold to Potiphar. And so when he got there as a slave, when Potiphar looked at Joseph, the Bible says that as a slave, the Lord was with Joseph and he prospered. Listen, the one thing I want you to get, and the theme that I want you to see, is that no matter where God sends you, that remember that he's with you. Remember that even in a situation as this, as he's in slavery, God is with him. And the other thing that's with him is he still has a dream. He still hadn't lost that dream. These dreams that I told, if you remember last week, I told you, the dreams that Joseph got were a preview of what was to come. Yes, it didn't look like it right now, but what God gave him was a preview of what was to come. But what he didn't give him was the path it was going to take him on and the obstacles he was going to have to face before he got there. He's already faced obstacle one, which was his family, throwing him into slavery. And so now he's a slave, and he's sitting here in Potiphar's possession as being sold to him, but the Lord was with him. And because the Lord was with him, even as a slave, he prospered. The Bible says that Potiphar looked at him and could see that the Lord was with him. And because he could see that the Lord was with him, what he did was he made sure that everything he had, he put in Joseph's hand. Joseph the slave now was responsible for everything. As a matter of fact, the Bible even tells us the only thing that Potiphar worried about was what he was going to eat that day. Why? Because Joseph was taking care of everything else. He put him in a position and raised him up even in slavery. And what I want to tell you is when you face obstacles on the way to realizing your dream, that God is still with you. And if he's with you, he has a way to elevate you where everybody else tried to put him down. His family wanted to put him down. His family didn't want to see him succeed. But even throwing him into slavery where they thought it was going to be a bad situation, things are looking up right now for Joseph. Joseph is sitting there. He's running everything. He's in control of everything. The Potiphar is giving him control. He's eating good. He's living good because he's living in Potiphar's house. God has made sure he's prospered in everything that he does, even in slavery. And listen, your obstacles, even though they may be tough or they may be hard, you don't go through them alone. God is with you. That's what you have to remind yourself. That's why we said don't forget who's with you. Because what we'll sometimes do is we'll say that the obstacle will make it look bigger than the dream. We'll think of the obstacle that you have to face, the thing that you're facing. He could look at slavery and looked at it as being bigger than what God promised him and what God told him in his dreams, but he didn't do so. He stayed faithful to God, and because he stayed faithful to God, God was with him and made sure that he prospered in the slavery situation. So this is what happened. Everything is looking up. Everything is going great for Joseph. Joseph's like, okay, cool. I can see I'm running stuff here. I got a nice position in the house. I'm over everything. Potiphar don't bother me. He let me take care of all the business. Stuff started to look like things were going well for Joseph. And then we hit obstacle number two, the obstacle that he had to face. Remember, take down these notes. Want to keep up with all these obstacles. After his family, obstacle one. The second one he had to deal with was lies. That's the second obstacle that we have to deal with, is lies. That's the second obstacle. So go ahead. We're going to start reading at Genesis 39, verse 6. And listen to what it says. It says, so Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care. With Joseph in charge, he did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. Now, Joseph was well-built and handsome. And after a while, his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, come to bed with me. But he refused. Joseph said, with me in charge, he told her, my master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owns has been entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? So Joseph is doing nothing but minding his business, doing his job, and doing his job very well. But Joseph, because Joseph was a nice, good-looking person, the wife starts to look at him like, wait a minute, I got to have some of that. Even though she's married to Potiphar, she says, nah, I need to have a piece. I want a piece. I want to see Joseph. And Joseph needs to come lay down and get in my bed with me. That's what the Bible says right there. So now he's stuck in this situation where the wife wants to get with him. And Joseph, he's smart enough to understand that not only is that wrong because of everything he's been blessed with, but it's also wrong because he sins against God. Listen, what he teaches us here, if we can pause right here for a moment, I can just impart a little bit of knowledge into you, is that when you are faced with a situation where you can mess up, there's the two things you need to think about. Think about all that God has blessed you with and all you've been blessed with, number one, and two, how that would look by sinning against God. Because when we're in the midst of it, when we want to mess up and make those decisions, we think of those bad decisions, we think of those things as being okay at that moment in time. We don't think about the consequences, the people that we're hurting, the people that we're letting down, and how we're sinning against God. But what Joseph was smart enough to realize is, wait a minute, I've been elevated to run everything. There's nobody in this house better than me. I'm the top dog in this house. And the only thing they told me not to do so I can keep my position is to stay away from you. And so what do you think? I'm going to do something this wicked and go against God, who's been with me, who's put me and elevated me in this position? Nah, not going to do it. And so Joseph said, nope, I'm not going to do it. But see, but Potiphar's wife was thirsty, y'all. She was real thirsty, and she wanted a drink of Joseph. She was real thirsty. She kept going after him. The Bible says day after day after day after day, she went after Joseph, telling him to come lie with him, come lay down with him. And Joseph, every time, shut it down. But then there was this one day. Joseph was minding his business, doing his work, but this happens to be a day where nobody else was around. And so when she noticed nobody else was around, she tried again, saying to come lay with him. She grabbed him, held on to him this time. She was very aggressive this time because there wasn't nobody around. And then all of a sudden, Joseph was like, you know what? I'm just going to run. And while running away, she grabbed his coat. The coat that he wears, a coat that signified, another coat that signified that he was the head of running the house, the manager of the entire house. She grabbed it. It came off of him, and Joseph ran so he didn't get away. That's what you should do to temptation. What Joseph teaches us there, you need to run. This wasn't a walk. This wasn't a scare. Joseph took off. He took off. He says, I don't want to be a part of none of this. If you're tempting me, you're coming after me. She grabbed the coat, he left it, and he ran off. That's what you should do. Joseph teaches another thing. When you're faced with temptation, don't stay around. Don't hang in it, because if you hang around with it, you might find yourself getting into it. So what Joseph says is, I'm going to run away as fast as possible from this temptation situation. And you know what happened? The wife got upset. She like, he's still turning me down. And so now she's upset that she's turning me down. She says, you know what? Forget it. I'm done with it. But I got his coat left here, or I'm going to lie about it. So let's look at what she says in Genesis verse 11. Genesis 39 verse 11. One day he went into the house to attend his duties, and none of the household servants was inside. She caught him by his cloak and said, come to bed with me. Told you, wasn't nobody there. But his cloak in her hand, and ran out of the house. Well, watch what she says. She says, when she saw that he had left his cloak in her hand and had run out of the house, she called her household servants. Look, she said to them, this Hebrew has been brought to us to make sport of us. He came in here to sleep with me, but I screamed. When he heard me scream for help, he left his cloak beside me and ran out the house. What? She just lied on him. She just told everybody, nope, look, I grabbed his coat, and when I told him to leave, I screamed, and I told him to leave, and when he left his coat here. He was trying to sleep with me. She twisted it around. So you know she told the servants, she's going to tell her husband, and she told her husband, and what else does the husband have to do? He's upset now. Now his wife is saying, this Hebrew, this servant, this slave that you brought in this house, that you put over all this stuff, tried to sleep with me. What you gonna do now? And now because Joseph didn't want to dishonor God, dishonor Potiphar, his boss, because Joseph did the right thing, it still finds himself ended up in jail. Potiphar was angry and upset and put him in prison. He's now a prisoner. He's now in jail. He's now bound by chains. All because he did the right thing. Listen, when God has gifted you and you don't do what other individuals want you to do, and they can't force you to act outside your character and put you in bad situations because you're running and you're fleeing away from temptation, you'll sometimes find that the best thing they can do to try to get to you is lie. Is try to lie about you. Try to lie to you. And that's what happened here. That was the second obstacle. He hadn't done anything wrong. Even in the first case, his first obstacle, he hadn't done anything wrong. It wasn't his fault that he was the favorite, but his brothers hated him and stole him. In this situation, he did everything right. He was putting himself in a great position to be head over the entire household, over his master's house. And the wife came in. She started messing with him. And because of what she did, because of the mistakes that she wanted to make with him, and he ran away. He did everything right. He ran away. He fled from temptation. And what do we see? What do we see? It ends him up in jail. Another situation. Now it looks again. What is it? You gave me these dreams. You give me these dreams, and then you throw these obstacles. I had to be thrown into slavery by my brothers. I had to be lied on. Now I'm thrown in jail. God, what's going on? I know you're with me. I know you made me prosper, but come on. Come on, God. What's next? But what he held on to was the fact that God was with him And I only need to hold on just to the fact that God was with him. He held on to the fact that he still had a dream. Despite of being in jail, despite of being a slave, he never did lose in anywhere so far in this story the dream and the promise that God had gave you. Now understand this. Because God gave him this dream, this wasn't just any dream. That was something that, hey, had this dream. It was fake. It wasn't real. No, this was a promise that God gave him. And sometimes what God will do is God will give you a dream, and that dream represents the destination, but it doesn't show you the map. Okay, when you use a map to go somewhere, right, you go in, it says where you're starting from. You put your current location. Then you put where you're going to. You put your destination. And when you put your destination in, there's a few options that come up. It gives you an option to see what's the fastest way, what's the easiest way, what's the way without tolls, what's the way without highways. It gives you all these different directions you can go in to get from one point from where you are to your destination. That way you have a step-by-step view before you ever walk out the house of where it is that you're going to go. And because you're in control of that, you know exactly which one you're going to take and where you want to go, and you're going to get there the easiest or the quickest way possible. Why? Because you're in control of how to get to your destination. But that's not how it always works with God. What God is going to do is he'll give you your destination first, but he won't give you the map. Because he's saying is, I need you to hold on to the destination, because there's going to be some obstacles that you face that are going to make you think that you're not going to make it. And if I let you know how hard it's going to be, you might forget about the destination, might forget about the dream coming true, and you might be stuck where you are because you're too scared to follow my path. This path for Joseph is full of obstacles. We face too. He had to deal with his family and deal with jail. But look at this, though. Would Joseph have taken that, knowing his dream, if God showed him the dream and the path to get there, would he have gone? Think about it. If God said, okay, I'm going to make you people, they're going to bow down to you. You're going to be in a higher position. That's where you're going to end up. But you're going to have to deal with your family throwing you into slavery, and you're going to have to deal with this woman lying on you and then getting you thrown in jail. Cool? He probably said, nah, I'm good. I don't even want it. That's why God can't show you that. That's why God says, I need you to hold on to the dream, because as you're getting there and you're facing these obstacles, I need you to know that I've still promised that I'm not going to leave you nor forsake you. I still promised that I'm going to get you to your dream. But in order to get you there, it's going to require you to get through some obstacles. Obstacles aren't stopping points. They're just building blocks to where God is trying to take you. And you have to understand and hold on to it and understand that despite where God takes you, despite the obstacles you face, you have to remember that the dream is still the dream and he has not left you yet. Which we told you already in verse 2, when he was a slave, he went into slavery. And the place that he ended up was in the house running everything. Why? Because verse 2 said that God was with him. Watch what happened if you look at verse 20. Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. But while Joseph was in the prison, the Lord was with him. We see it again. Even in jail, he was with them in slavery. Now in jail, it says, even in prison, the Lord was with him. You have to remember, no matter where God takes you, the obstacles that he put in front of you, it may be a surprise to you, but it's not a surprise to him. He knows the destination, and he knows how he's going to get you there. You just don't know. It's a surprise and shock to you, but God says, I already planned this whole thing out. I knew you were going to end up there. And because I knew you were going to end up there, I'm going to be with you so that when you get there, I'm going to have your back. Watch what happened right here. Watch what happened right here. It says that the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. It's something that every time the Lord is with Joseph, the person who's in charge of where he is always shown kindness and favor towards him. Why? Because when the Lord is with you, the Lord sets stuff up on your behalf. The Lord begins to work things out for you. The Lord begins to make things happen for you just because he's with you. Watch this. Watch this. He says the warden is in charge of everybody. The warden runs the prison. That's his job, is to run the prison. And he sold favor. Joseph got favor from the person that runs the prison. So much so, verse 22, 22 says, the warden put Joseph in charge of all those held in the prison. So now Joseph was a prisoner, but now he was a prisoner running the prison. Watch this. Everywhere that Joseph has gone so far, he's been in charge. No matter what it is, he's been in charge. He's a slave and he's a prisoner, but he was the head slave in one spot running everything. He's the head prisoner in his other spot over everybody else. When God is with you, he has the chance to take what everybody else doesn't want and elevate you to a spot to where when you get there, you're like, okay, it's not as bad as I thought. Why? Because God is with you. God said, I've already set it up for you. Don't worry about it. You're worrying about what's going to happen while you're there. God is saying, I've already took care of that. That's why I'm with you. I just need you to trust me along the way. The destination hadn't changed. Your dream hadn't changed. It's still going to come true. Whatever it is that God's giving you as a dream, it's still going to happen. But in those obstacles you face, don't fret about it. Don't worry about it. Don't get scared or upset about it. Understand and know and remember who's with you. Because if he's with you, he has the opportunity to bless you and show you favor in unfavorable situations. Slavery is not favorable, but being in charge and being in the master's house, he ate good. He lived good. He slept good. Everything was good for Joseph as a slave. Even the process of being lied about isn't a good obstacle to face as well. But when he was lied about and thrown in jail, when he got to jail, all of a sudden he's over the prisoners. He's running everything. It's not as bad as he thought it was going to be. Why? Because God is with him. And we're going to see throughout this entire story about Joseph how the dream's going to come true, but how through every obstacle he faces, God is with him. You have to understand there's a different type of confidence, a different type of swag you have when God's with you. It's a different type of thing. Talk to somebody that's gone through something without God. Talk to somebody that's going through something with God. You'll see they'll go through the same exact story and have two different outcomes. Why? Because when you have God with you, he begins to change and maneuver things around to where it works out on your behalf. And we know the Bible says that all things work together for your good. All things. He didn't say all good things, all favorable things, all things that we pray for. No, he said everything, the good, the bad, and the ugly, when you love him, works together. And what happened is Joseph never stopped trusting and believing and loving on God, so that God elevated him. We saw twice God was with him. And the reason why he was and when he's with you, he has the ability to elevate you past your situation. So that's my encouragement to you today, that no matter the obstacles you face on your way to your dream coming true, remember this, that God is with you. Don't forget, in the midst of what you're going through, and as hard as it may be, don't forget who's with you. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, most gracious God, we thank you, God, that you're just a God that when we're going through things, when we're in places that look unfavorable, you won't leave us. God, your word says that you'll never leave us nor forsake us, God. And in those moments where we need you the most, God, we're just thankful that you're a God that shows up each and every time. God, we just ask that everyone on here who's a dreamer, everyone on here who's you've put a dream in their minds and giving them hope and showing them what their future is going to be like, God, that you give them confidence in this series to continue to go along the journey no matter what obstacles they may face. Continue to strengthen them, God. Let them know, God, not to allow the obstacles and the detours and the problems to be bigger than the promise that you've given them, dear Heavenly Father. God, watch over, God, and keep them, God, through this entire series, God. Allow those dreams that they thought were dead to come back alive because of this series, dear Heavenly Father, God, and speak to those hearts, God, for them to always remember that no matter what they go through, you are with them. It's in the mighty, matchless name of the Master we do pray. Amen. Listen, I hope that message was a blessing to you. We're going to go back. We're going to dig deeper into some of these things in the text. I want to hear from you all. So that means if we're going to dig deeper, we're doing that on Wednesday nights. If we're doing it on Wednesday nights, that means I need you all available Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. on Zoom to show up. Listen, we are on Zoom every single Wednesday. The same link. If you had a link from a month ago, if you had a link from a couple weeks ago, click on that same link. You're going to find us in the same spot every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. for LJ3 Bible Study Live. Don't miss it. Listen, we really want you there. Listen, we have a lot of things coming up in the church, so make sure you stay connected. Make sure you're checking your emails from me. You're in the GroupMe chat. And if you're not in the GroupMe chat, send me an email, emacmillanjr@newfaithchurch.org, and let me know, and I can definitely be sure to get you added there. Listen, I cannot wait for you guys to hear the rest of this series. I've been waiting. Listen, I told the people on Wednesday, this series has been on my heart for at least 6 months. I was trying to wait until we got together again after all this corona stuff happened. But, you know, God had other plans, so I need to release it now. So listen, keep watching this series. I need you to keep going because I know it. We talked about it on Wednesday. Y'all have dreams. God's giving you something. And I don't want you to lose sight on the dreams that God gave you just because you might deal with a few obstacles along the way. So make sure you're tuning in each and every Sunday. Make sure you're back with us on Wednesdays to talk deeper into it. Listen, I love you guys, and there's nothing you can do about it. It's Pastor E. You all have a great week.